So I'm Louise Marks, I'm from Carers Trust, and some of you might know me because I've worked for 10 years at Suffolk Family Carers and I've worked for quite some time in the Waverley area, so across the border, and worked with Howard quite a lot on a range of forums. So when I moved to Carers Trust, I think Howard thought, well, what's Louise doing now, dementia? I'll collar her in and I'll do a dementia forum. So I said to Howard, what would be a really good idea is to base it around a road less rocky, because a lot of the work I do at Carers Trust is based around the road less rocky. And my role is to raise the profile of carers caring for somebody with dementia and to let the powers that be know what a difficult role that is, and that people caring for someone with dementia have quite specific needs of their own. So wherever I can get my voice heard, in Parliament and in meetings at health and social care, I feel that I am the voice of carers, and I hope that I do a good job in just keep ploughing away and saying what people's needs are. I think it's very difficult, you know, especially at the moment, because you feel that you're saying the same things, and there's a vision out there from the Prime Minister, but when you see people on the ground, they're still often finding it very, very difficult. So sort of trying to get those two tied up, which I would love to do. I don't know if I ever will. So a bit about Road Less Rocky. So it was a bit of research done by, it was commissioned by Carers Trust and done by university. And what they did is they consulted in lots of different ways with carers. So they had focus groups, they had questionnaires, they did one-to-ones, all of those things that you're supposed to do when you do research. And what they found was that along what they call a carer's journey of caring for somebody with dementia, they found that there was 10 really important points in that journey that had carers been given better information and advice and support, that road would have been less rocky. I'm not saying it would be easy, because I don't think it's ever going to be easy, but a little less difficult had they been given information. So they pinpointed these 10 critical points, and then within those 10 points there was two areas that really came out prominently to say these were the times when people started to consider whether they were able to care anymore. And these are when people's changing behaviours become very difficult for the carer to understand and to do the best thing for, and also when somebody becomes incontinent, which is something I never really considered enough, I don't think, until I read the document, about how those two things really impact upon a carer's ability to continue really without really good support, and that those are the times where often people look at residential care. And maybe, had they been given more help and support at home, they may not have needed to do that. So what the forum will do is go, what we've done is had a look at the 10 critical points, and if we can put the slide up a little bit, you can work your way through them, and then built the day around them, because this is what carers told us they wanted to know and what is important to them. So hopefully the day will reflect what carers have told us and give carers like yourselves the information that will go some way to help that journey, really. So I might be better to read it off here, really.
Sorry.
I should remember them off by heart now. But the 10 critical points that carers recognised were, firstly, when there's first a diagnosis, or in fact going a bit earlier than that and actually trying to get a diagnosis, and all those difficulties. The next one was when the carer is starting to take on much more of an active caring role. So doing more and more, and sometimes not even realising that their workload as a carer is increasing. So little by little, a carer is starting to do more and more to be able to support that person to live in the community. And while they're doing that, quite often forget about their own needs. And it's a very gradual process. So we hope today to give you some insight into how to look after yourselves as well, and to think that you are the most important people, because without you, the person who's trying to live in the community with dementia is going to really struggle, and that you are really, really important. And the next one is about the capacity of somebody with dementia, when that starts to decline, and that can be a really hard issue for carers, when they have to start to make decisions on somebody's behalf and worrying about whether they've made the right one or if that's what that person would like. So hopefully someone talk about forward planning, to talk to the person, so you feel more comfortable to know what their wishes would have been. The next one is about emotional support for carers. And then when mobility declines as well. I mean, of course, with most people who have dementia are older, so may already have mobility concerns. But for some people, their mobility was very good on diagnosis and then may decline as the dementia progresses. So that was a really important point for carers, to know how to adapt the house, how to still be able to go out and get involved in activities that they've always wanted. The next one is around people who have what they call in the scientific world comorbidities, which is more than one health condition at a time. So, and having to manage that with somebody who has dementia can be quite difficult because their memory is affected, as we all know. So if you have a condition such as diabetes, remembering to eat at the right time and to take your medication can be an extra strain. And there are quite a large number of people that will have more than one condition. And someone in the report, her husband had 7 other medical conditions that she was trying to manage as well. So the next one is about behaviour, and we talked about that a little bit at the beginning, about how that really impacts upon people. And hopefully today you'll learn some strategies and some techniques that are really going to assist you to help the person that you care for, and hopefully make your own life a little less stressful. The next one is about carer circumstances and when they change. So right at the beginning I was saying that, you know, carers, you need to look after yourself. You are really important. And people who care for someone with dementia will be caring for many, many years. And throughout those years, there are going to be some changes in your circumstances. There's no doubt about it. It might be if you were working that you've had to reduce hours or given up work, or maybe you maybe didn't need to if you'd have or somebody had given information about flexible working and stuff like that. And people's families sometimes change, so you might, your best support that might have been another family member suddenly moves to another part of the country. You know, your circumstances are going to change. And also carers, of course, have their own health issues. And many carers of people with dementia are older themselves, so are more likely to have their own health issues. So the next one is around incontinence and what big issue that has and the impact it has on carers. Yet again, with more information, advice and support, it could be much easier for carers. And the next one and the last one is about when decisions are made around residential care and end-of-life care. And this week is Dementia Awareness Week and Dying Matters Week. I'm not sure that putting those two together is really very good, but it is, so we have to grasp it. And you know, it's a very difficult subject, talking about dying, but we all should consider a plan for a time when we might be dying, you know, and to make sure that it's what we would have wanted, you know. So, a little like we all make a will, we should all think about making a last and power of attorney and an advanced decision and an advanced directive about what we would want. Because not only does it comfort us in the fact that we know that we will get what we would like at the end of our life, but also it's a real comfort to relatives because they know that they will be doing the right thing for you and following what would have been your wishes. And sometimes they can be very simple things, like you always want fresh flowers in the house, it's what you've always wanted, you've been a vegetarian so don't give them meat. You know, all these things, as well as the important things about where you would like to die and what treatment you would want. So it's looking at it very broadly. So, without further ado, I'd like to open the day. I'm here all day, which is about 4:30. And so please come and speak to me. I love to gather information and experiences of carers so that I can feed them right up into the people that hopefully can make changes. So I'm open ears. And then at lunchtime, what I'll do is I've made a toolkit to go with the road less rocky, which people can follow through to get the advice that sort of goes with the day. So what I'll do is I'll put it up on the internet at lunchtime and people can have a look. It went up in a rush on Friday because I was really keen to have it up for Dementia Awareness Week, but I think it needs twiggling about now. You know, it's not until you put something on the web that you realise it's not quite how you wanted it. But it is a really good resource. And what I hope it will do is help people who work with carers or come across carers in their everyday life not to be frightened to ask that question, are you a carer? And to identify you and help you to identify yourself as such. And then to be able to at least signpost you to the right service, whether that be a carer service or a dementia service. Because I think some people who work in health and social care don't ask the question because they're frightened, because they don't know the answer. But as we all know, there's no right answer. It's just about hearing what you have to say and thinking about where you might be able to pinpoint that person for some more support. So I'm hoping the toolkit will do that, just give more confidence to people working and coming across carers to recognise them and what have you. So thank you very much.